Welcome to lesson 8 of stoichiometric organometallics. Today's subject is enantioselective deprotonation, or what we need for enantioselective deprotonating a substrate is, of course, a chiral base. Very often, as chiral bases, sterically hindered lithium amides are applied. For instance, this one, let's call that chiral base A. Of course, this is related to LDA. Another one, more sophisticated, has a functional heterocyclic system which will chelate the lithium. Let's call that B. Similar to B, is this one. See, and another example call it D, clearly derives from the amino acid proline. Well, forming the amide of this amino acid with pyrrolidine, and then reducing the remaining carbonyl group simply with lithium aluminum hydride will lead us to this derivative that simply has to be lithiated with butyllithium, that we have the lithium amide. So, examples, what can we do with bases like that? For instance, we can achieve this transformation, this achiral ketone is transferred to this one, this which is chiral and has one CH2 group missing. Marvelous reaction, not to be achieved in one preparative step, of course, but applying several steps. So, how could we do this transformation? Well, it's clear that this is achiral because we have that mirror plane here, and if we draw it as the chair conformation, then it's clear if we deprotonate here or there we would get to an enolate, and the enolate then is chiral. A tertiary butyl group, and we can trap that enolate with trimethylsilyl chloride. To get to the TMS enol ether, which is to be stored and applied in the next step. This is the S enantiomer. Well, and we get to the S enantiomer by deprotonating, for instance, this proton, while deprotonating the other hydrogen or delivers the other enantiomer. So that means that our chiral base has to discriminate between those hydrogens. In THF at minus 78 degrees, this is usually tried, and it works. For instance, with base A, we get a 67% yield and an enantiomeric excess of 84%. With base B, a lower yield, 51%, but a very high enantiomeric excess of 97%. Well, and with base C, 'successfully' the yield was increased up to 88%. Or with a bit minor diminished enantiomeric excess. What do we have to do to get to this structure? Well, obviously we have to get rid of one carbon. There is one reaction from organic chemistry 2, you know, where you lose a carbon. This is if you have a beta keto ester, which you hydrolyze, then it decarboxylates. And this is the way to do. We oxidize this double bond, could be by ozonolysis and then later on further oxidizing the aldehyde, or directly oxidizing this molecule with potassium permanganate until the oxidation state of the diacid. Esterification and then treatment of a diester under basic conditions, sodium ethanolate. Well, then you have a Diekmann cyclization well, you will get somewhat a mixture of this isomer and the one who has the ester group here at this position, but after hydrolysis of the ester and decarboxylation, you get always the same final product. Next example. An A chiral epoxide, but with all functional groups on the same side of the ring. This here is a TBDMS protecting group at for the alcohol functionality here. TBDMS is tertiary butyl dimethyl silyl. So this group has this structure, and compared to a trimethyl silyl protecting group, the TBDMS group is less sensitive against hydrolysis. For instance, it's no problem to make a column chromatography on a silica gel with a TBDMS protecting group. This is difference to the TMS group. So it's much more easy to handle, therefore. With base D in benzene, an unpolar solvent at 4 degrees, an elimination reaction occurs. Leading us enantioselectively to this, still at one position, TBDMS protected cyclohexene diol. And this transformation is achieved with 92% yield and 90% enantiomeric excess. So for those who do not know what is enantiomeric excess, 90% enantiomeric excess means a ratio. We have a ratio of 95:5. And the difference in percent between the one enantiomer and the other is 90, because 95 minus 5 is 90. That's it. Very simple. Usually, chiral alcohols like that are then oxidized to alpha, beta unsaturated ketones, still a chiral system, and these type of products are important for prostaglandin synthesis, very important hormones. Or we should ask, where do we get this starting material from? Most syntheses for functionalized cyclopentanes start from the cheapest available starting material, which is, of course, cyclopentadiene in this case. You buy it as a Diels Alder dimer, and then, of course, crack it at 180 degrees, and you have that liquid with 40 degrees boiling point. Here is the transformation to this starting material. First step, a hydroboration. Secondly, the usual oxidative workup of the boranes, make a monohydroboration, and the oxidative workup will lead you to this alcohol. Or the regioselectivity of this reaction is simply explained because with that hydroboration you get the anti-Markovnikov alcohol. Yeah. And this is, of course, the anti-Markovnikov alcohol. Now we have to accomplish that the epoxidation takes place on the same side of the ring as the hydroxyl group already occupies. How could we do that? Well, the oxidizing agent has to coordinate at that hydroxyl group, and the oxygen has to be transferred then intramolecularly. We can do that with tertiary butyl hydroperoxide, this one, in connection with a metal catalyst, vanadyl acetyl acetonate. In short, it's then vanadyl aquac. Somehow this sounds expensive. It isn't. It's 50 grams you can get nowadays for 63 euros. Well, and then you have to introduce this protecting group, which is somewhat more expensive than compared to the vanadyl aquac. Okay. Let us compare this synthesis to a chiral functionalized cyclopentanone with another classic one from the group of Winterfeld in Hanover. He also started with cyclopentadiene. In the first step, he lets this react with singlet oxygen. Well, simply irradiating molecular oxygen in the presence of a sensitizer, usually this is a dye called Bengal rose, Bengal rosa in German. And that singlet oxygen undergoes a Diels-Alder reaction. F forming this endo peroxide. Now we have to reduce this oxygen-oxygen bond, which we can achieve with thiourea as a reducing agent. This works just fine in methanol. And this delivers then the achiral diol with both hydroxyl groups on the same side of the ring. A double acetylation then gives the double acetic acid ester, and now follows the step Winterfeld introduces the chiral information, an enzymatic step, an enzymatic cleavage with acetyl cholinesterase. Enantioselectively, one ester is hydrolyzed, well, and now again an oxidation under suitable reaction conditions leads to the chiral and additionally functionalized cyclopentanone, similar to the one we have seen before. Now two examples, very interesting examples, which actually work very well, where we add a chiral ligand which transforms our butyllithium to a chiral base, because this chiral ligand coordinates to the lithium of the butyllithium, at the same time breaking up the butyllithium hexamer or tetramer and increasing its reactivity. This chemistry was initially developed by Dieter Hoppe. From Münster University. And it's sometimes simply called Hoppe chemistry. So, what he applies is a natural product, spartine, isolated from plants, lupines. And if you buy spartine, you get that, 100 milliliters for about 250 euros. What's the structure of spartine? Well, it's a bit more complicated. Yes, this is correct. So, and that you can better imagine the structure, if we add butyllithium, then the lithium is chelated between those two nitrogens. One, two, three, four, five, six. That's okay. Yes. And here at this position, then the alkyl lithium is coordinated, chelated. Usually, this is secondary butyllithium. What can you achieve with applying that? Finally, it's a transformation of, for instance, a primary alcohol to a chiral secondary alcohol. Where you have the chiral center, alpha to the alcohol and alpha to a formerly electrophilic group you had, to a group that had been electrophilic and you had introduced it. So E can be, for instance, allyl, benzyl, carboxylic acid. Well, TMS group. Well, in that case, you should keep protecting group at the alcohol. Also, an SR group. This would be a thio semi. Acetal, also in this case, you need to keep a protecting group at the OH group. Otherwise, it wouldn't be stable, of course. You can't achieve that directly. You have to have, of course, a protecting group here. And it is a special one, a carbamate. As the diisopropyl amide. The combination of ZEC butyllithium and spartine is able to discriminate between those two hydrogens. And this one is preferentially deprotonated. This organolithium compound is configurationally stable up to minus 30 degrees. You can then trap it with the electrophilic reagent, for instance, allylic bromide, and usually this is very successful with very high enantiomeric excess and a very good yield. One problem you of course have is how could you synthesize the other enantiomer since nature produces only minus spartine. Hoppe's group found out that you can perform a transmetallation under inversion of a stereogenic center with titanium tetrakis isopropoxide. Well, and if you trap this one with a suitable electrophile, then you have the opposite stereogenic center compared to the direct lithiation trapping process. Here's a nice example. First, treating this well, symmetrical molecule with secondary butyllithium in the presence of spartiene. Secondly, trapping the organolithium species with CO2. Then hydrolyzation under moderate reaction conditions. Will lead us to this chiral carboxylic acid. Hydrolyzation under more rigorous conditions, 5 molar HCl, 90 degrees, 12 hours, hydrolyzes off the protecting groups, the carbamate groups. giving rise to that acid, which might already under these reaction conditions finally undergo a lactonization. Giving this final product, absolute configuration should be R here and of course also R there. And the whole transformation is done with an 80% yield and more than 95% enantiomeric excess. Peter Beek group, which we already know from the endocyclic restriction test, studied the enantioselective deprotonation of pyrrolidine derivatives, again with secondary butyllithium and spartiine. This protecting group is called a Bock group for tertiary butyl oxycarbamoyl and here we have the B and there the O and there the C. This forms the term Bock. So again, secondary butyllithium and spartiine lithiates that Bock-protected pyrrolidine alpha to the nitrogen. And then we can again trap with a suitable electrophile ending at the aimed products with up to 88% yield and up to 98% enantiomeric excess. Of course, you can use that, for instance, for a synthesis of the amino acid proline, but you wouldn't do so because this proline is comparable cheap. Okay. Well, also from Peter Beek's group is this transformation. With secondary butyllithium, spartiine. Reaction performed in toluene at minus 78 degrees. The benzylic position is enantioselectively deprotonated. And then we have here the nucleophilic center, which reacts intramolecularly with that carbon as the electrophilic center, well, simply an SN2 reaction intramolecularly. And, well, you end up again with pyrrolidines similar to those, but here, well, essentially the opposite stereochemistry. 72% yield and 96% enantiomeric excess. Well, a couple of lessons ago, we talked about DOM reactions. And again, from Victor Snikus' group, there are enantioselective DOM reactions applying Hoppe chemistry. Ferrocene, functionalized ferrocene, is used again with well, the same diisopropyl amide as we already know from the usual Hoppe chemistry. Now with N-butyl lithium, spartine, in diethyl ether, minus 78 degrees. Well, and secondly, the electrophile, one example reported was benzophenone. The product was isolated as the structure. Percent yield and an impressive 99% enantiomeric excess was reported. This is a chiral product, a planar chiral, so planar chirality is the case here. And a final example for today from Scott Denmark's group. Here we have an amino functionality, and we treat that with N-butyl lithium, also in the presence of spartine, in diethyl ether, minus 94 degrees was reported. Secondly, cautious hydrolysis. Well, one might think that the base would deprotonate here However, we wouldn't get a chiral lithiation because with deprotonation an enamine would be formed. No, in this case, N-butyl lithium doesn't react as a base, but as a nucleophile. A nucleophilic attack at that positively polarized carbon, and our nucleophile, coordinated by the spartiene, is then a chiral nucleophile. The final product is a secondary amine which was isolated in 90% yield and 91% enantiomeric excess. Enough for today. Next week we will talk about stereo control in other types of organometallic reactions. Thank you for listening. See you next week.